We are also going live on YouTube. So in 2 minutes, we will start the live also on YouTube.
नमस्ते अमरीश।
हाय अनीता जी, कैसे हैं?
हाय अनी, कैन यू हियर? इज द साउंड ओके?
यस, साउंड इज देयर, वी कांट सी यू।
यस, आई हैव जस्ट
ओनली आकाशवाणी।
यू नो दिस द ज़ूम एक्चुअली गिव्स यू द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू बी लाइक अ घोस्ट, सो यू कैन यू आर डिसअपीयरिंग एंड अपीयरिंग।
इट्स लेफ्ट टू आवर इमेजिनेशन वेदर इट इज अ घोस्ट और एन एंजल।
But now people have started meeting in a small gathering.
Yeah.
Yes.
Telling the distance.
I don't know how long it will continue. Now it is increasing again.
Yes, it's increasing again. It's
people really have gone up from pure to hybrid.
Yes. Yes.
These gatherings are called hybrid gatherings.
Yes.
And it's going up a lot suddenly. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Big way.
So I think we need to start.
Huh? Yes, we. It's yes. Almost 140 people have joined. We can start.
All right.
We should start because.
Yes.
You know.
Okay.
For the webinar, we can't have ki koi 10 baje aa rahe hai, koi 11 baje aa rahe hai, koi 12 baje aa rahe hai.
साथियों, ये इस आज के महत्वपूर्ण वेबिनार में हम आप सबका राइट टू एजुकेशन फोरम की तरफ से स्वागत करते हैं। इस वेबिनार में देश के विभिन्न हिस्सों से सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस के लोग, एजुकेशनिस्ट, टीचर्स हिस्सा ले रहे हैं, और इसलिए कि आज का दिन बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण है शिक्षा के, हमारे भारत की शिक्षा व्यवस्था के लिए भी और यूनिवर्सलाइजेशन के लिए बहुत महत्वपूर्ण दिन है। 1 अप्रैल 2010 को शिक्षा अधिकार कानून एक संवैधानिक जिम्मेदारी के रूप में को पूरा करने के लिए संसद के दोनों सदनों द्वारा पारित किया गया 2009 में, और 1 अप्रैल 2010 को ये देश भर में लागू किया गया, और तब से लगातार इसके अमल के लिए संघर्ष चल रहे हैं। शिक्षा अधिकार कानून एक संवैधानिक जिम्मेदारी के रूप में आया था और एलिमेंट्री लेवल पर सभी लोगों को बिना भेदभाव पूर्ण शिक्षा मुहैया कराने के संकल्प के साथ लाया गया था। हालांकि इसमें पहले से ही ये मांग थी कि प्री प्राइमरी और सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन को भी संवैधानिक जिम्मेदारी में शामिल किया जाए और इसको कानून के जरिए पूरे स्कूल एजुकेशन को लागू करने की बात शुरू से उठाई गई थी, लेकिन प्री प्राइमरी और सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन को इससे अलग कर दिया गया और 1 से 8 तक शिक्षा को यूनिवर्सलाइज करने के संकल्प के साथ ये कानून सामने आया। और बहुत सारी चीजें इस कानून ने एक बड़ा नया उत्साह देश के अंदर, खास तौर से जो गांव के इलाकों रहने वाले लोग हैं, स्लम्स में रहने वाले लोग, मार्जिनलाइज्ड चिल्ड्रन हैं, फैमिली हैं, उन सब लोगों के अंदर भी एक बड़ा उत्साह था कि उनके बच्चे भी अब गुणवत्तापूर्ण शिक्षा बिना किसी भेदभाव के राज्य के प्रयासों से हासिल कर लेंगे। और आप सब जानते हैं कि यह कानून इस रूप में देश के अंदर देखा गया कि यह शिक्षा एक पब्लिक गुड है, ह्यूमन राइट है, इसे हासिल करने का सभी को अधिकार है, और अंतर्राष्ट्रीय और राष्ट्रीय स्तर पर यह देश की और दुनिया की जिम्मेदारी है कि हर बच्चे को पब्लिक फंड से शिक्षा उपलब्ध कराई जाए और कोई भी बच्चा शिक्षा से वंचित न रहे। इस लिहाज से इसका बड़ा स्वागत हुआ और काफी उत्साह के साथ लोगों ने इसको लागू करने की कोशिशें शुरू की। और आप जानते हैं कि 13-14 में 98.5% इनरोलमेंट का स्तर हो गया, नामांकन का स्तर हो गया, और बड़े पैमाने पर लड़कियों ने भी दाखिला लिया। बहुत सारे स्कूल बनाए गए, 99% रूरल एरियाज में 1 किलोमीटर के अंदर प्राइमरी स्कूल बने। हालांकि इस कानून में जो दो बड़ी कमजोरियां थी, एक तो कि प्री प्राइमरी और सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन इसके साथ नहीं जुड़ा था और दूसरा कोई फाइनेंशियल मेमोरेंडम इस कानून के साथ नहीं था, जिसके लिए बार बार आवाजें उठी और तापस मजूमदार कमेटी ने तो पूरा कैलकुलेशन भी किया, उसके बावजूद भी कोई फाइनेंशियल मेमोरेंडम इस कानून के साथ था। फिर भी इस कानून में बहुत सारी चीजें ऐसी थी जिससे कि लोगों के अंदर एक काफी शिक्षा के प्रति उत्साह पैदा हुआ। एक तो कि दाखिला, किसी भी बच्चे का दाखिले से इनकार नहीं किया जाएगा, एज एप्रोप्रिएट एडमिशन होगा और आउट ऑफ स्कूल बच्चों की स्पेशल ट्रेनिंग की जाएगी। दूसरा ये कि कोई बच्चा फेल नहीं किया जाएगा, ये बच्चे की जिम्मेदारी नहीं बल्कि स्कूल की जिम्मेदारी है और इसलिए कंटिन्यूअस कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव इवेल्युएशन चलेगा, निरंतर इवेल्युएशन किया जाएगा। और एक इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर होगा, पहली बार स्कूल डिफाइन किया गया आजादी के अंदर कानून के जरिए, और हर स्कूल के अंदर नॉर्म्स एंड स्टैंडर्ड तय किए गए कि एक स्कूल के अंदर क्या जरूरत है, और प्राइवेट स्कूलों को भी उन्हीं नॉर्म्स एंड स्टैंडर्ड के आधार पर रिकॉग्निशन लेने के लिए कहा गया। ये बहुत सारी चीजें, कॉन्ट्रेक्चुअल टीचर्स के फिनोमिनन को टाइम बाउंड खत्म करने की बात कही गई, रेगुलर और कॉन्ट्रैक्ट टीचर देश के बच्चों को दिए जाएंगे। और टाइमलाइन था इस कानून में 2013 और 2015। 2015 तक देश के सारे बच्चों के लिए स्कूल, उनके नजदीक में स्कूल मुहैया कराने की बात कही गई और उसके लिए ट्रेन टीचर्स देने की बात तय की गई इस कानून के जरिए। तो ये बहुत सारा स्कूली शिक्षा व्यवस्था के अंदर एक क्रांतिकारी बदलाव लाने की नीयत से यह कानून, यह दस्तावेज सामने आया। इसको एक कैरिकुलम की भी बात की गई, एनसीएफ 2005 के साथ लिंक किया गया और इसको लेकर के पूरे देश में सरकारी और गैर सरकारी स्तर पर कुछ प्रयास शुरू किए गए। हालांकि एक चीज जो सबसे ज्यादा महत्वपूर्ण थी और जिसके ऊपर पूरा सारा इम्प्लीमेंटेशन का दारोमदार टिका हुआ था, और वो था रिसोर्सेज का। रिसोर्सेज जो चाहिए थे, वो रिसोर्सेज साल दर साल जाने के बावजूद भी हम मुहैया नहीं करा पाए, सरकारें मुहैया नहीं करा पाई, और जिसकी वजह से आज जब हम 11 साल पूरे होने के बाद इस कानून की चर्चा कर रहे हैं तो देश में इसका 12.6% स्कूल्स में ही इसका अमल हो पाया है। 1.5 मिलियन स्कूल्स में केवल 12.6% स्कूल में हम इस कानून को 11 साल होने के बाद भी पूरा कर पाए। अभी भी 9 लाख एलिमेंट्री लेवल पर टीचर्स की वैकेंसी है। 53.8% स्कूल्स हैं जिनमें पीने का पानी, हाथ धोने की सुविधा और फंक्शनल टॉयलेट है। अभी भी आप देखिए तो 47% स्कूल्स हैं जिनमें अभी भी पीने का पानी नहीं है, ड्रिंकिंग वाटर नहीं है और टॉयलेट, फंक्शनल टॉयलेट नहीं है। जबकि कानून ने लड़कियों की शिक्षा को, ड्रॉप आउट को रोकने के लिए और लड़कियों को प्रोत्साहित करने के लिए एक सेपरेट टॉयलेट गर्ल्स को बनाए जाने की बात कही थी। बहुत सारे इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चरल सुझाव थे इस कानून के अंदर, लेकिन हम अभी भी 46% 47% स्कूलों में वो सुविधाएं उपलब्ध नहीं करा पाए। 8.3% स्कूल हैं, ये सरकार के आंकड़े हैं, जिसमें सिंगल टीचर स्कूल, सिंगल टीचर है, एक अध्यापक के भरोसे 8.3%, मतलब 1 लाख स्कूल वो अभी चल रहे हैं। तो इस कानून को के प्रति आने के बाद जिस तरह का उत्साह था लोगों के अंदर और जिस तरह से दाखिला लिया बच्चों ने और गरीब परिवारों में भी ये खुशी की लहर आ गई, खर्चे से उनके बच्चे 8वीं तक की शिक्षा पूरी करेंगे और ये उम्मीद थी कि ये शिक्षा का अधिकार कानून 12वीं तक एक्सटेंड किया जाएगा और स्कूली शिक्षा का कार्यभार, पूरा भार देश लेगा, देश की जनता लेगी, देश की सरकार लेगी। यह जो था, लेकिन अमल जो है बिल्कुल जिस तरह का पैथेटिक अमल हुआ और रिसोर्सेज की कमी, ट्रेन टीचर्स की कमी, इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर की कमी, उसने जो है, और फिर उसके बाद इस कानून को धीरे धीरे डाइल्यूट करने की भी कोशिशें की गई। नो डिटेंशन पॉलिसी में अमेंडमेंट लाए गए और बहुत सारे प्रयास किए गए और इस कानून को इस बच्चों के एक जस्टिसिएबल राइट के बजाय एक स्कीम की तरह लागू करने की कोशिशें हुई, एक स्कीम जिसके बारे में कोई अकाउंटेबल नहीं। यह जो एक संवैधानिक जिम्मेदारी थी देश और प्रदेश की सरकारों की, उस संवैधानिक जिम्मेदारी को पूरा करने में हम ये कह सकते हैं 11 साल होने के बाद कि सरकार फेल हुई और अब अपना मुंह चुराने की कोशिश कर रही है। जो न्यू एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में, नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में साफ साफ दिखाई देता है, जिसमें इस कानून का, अगर नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में अच्छा होता कि वो इस कानून का विश्लेषण करते, इसके अमल का विश्लेषण करते और खामियों का की निशानदेही करते और फिर उसके लिए क्या उपाय किए जाएंगे इसको बताया जाता है। लेकिन नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी ने कानून से अपने को दरकिनार कर लिया, ये कहते हुए कि SDG 4 है, सस्टेनेबल डेवलपमेंट गोल्स 4 को पूरा करना है 2030 तक और उसके लिए 3 से 18 साल के बच्चों की शिक्षा को यूनिवर्सलाइज करना है। कैसे यूनिवर्सलाइज करना है ये नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी बताती नहीं है। कस्तूरी रंगन कमेटी ने जो सुझाव दिया था कि कानून एक व्हीकल हो सकता है, इसलिए कानून को 3 से 18 साल तक की उम्र के बच्चों के लिए इसको एक्सटेंड किया जाए और कानून के जरिए स्कूली शिक्षा को यूनिवर्सलाइज किया जाए, भारत सरकार के कैबिनेट ने नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी को मंजूर करते समय कस्तूरी रंगन कमेटी के इस सुझाव को ड्रॉप कर दिया, उसको बाहर कर दिया और कानून से अपना एक कुछ नए प्रॉमिस नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी में दिखाए बताए और वो जो नए प्रॉमिसेज हैं वो भी इस बार कहीं भी बजट में दिखाई नहीं दिए। तो इसलिए हम इस वेबिनार में, आप जानते हैं कि इस वेबिनार में हम एक बार फिर रिक्लेम कर रहे हैं राइट टू एजुकेशन, क्योंकि कोरोना महामारी के बाद जब एक साल से हमारे सारे स्कूल बंद हैं, 1.5 मिलियन स्कूल्स बंद हैं, बच्चे घरों में हैं और जो ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन है उसने लगभग 75% बच्चों के शिक्षा के अधिकार का उल्लंघन किया है कि क्योंकि ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन 25% बच्चों जाती है, उसकी रीच वहीं तक है और जो भी हमारे गांव के गरीब परिवारों के दलित, आदिवासी, मुस्लिम लड़कियां और डिसेबल बच्चे हैं वो इस ऑनलाइन फैसिलिटी से बिल्कुल बाहर हैं और उनके राइट टू एजुकेशन का वायलेशन हुआ है, उसके लिए कोई इंतजाम नहीं किया गया। तो इसलिए जब ये कोरोना महामारी के बाद हम देखते हैं कि हमारे बच्चे अब बहुत सारे चाइल्ड लेबर हो गए, अर्ली चाइल्ड मैरिजेज हो रही है, चाइल्ड ट्रैफिकिंग हो रही है, और जो कहा जा रहा है कि 3 करोड़ बच्चे 3.4 करोड़ बच्चे आउट ऑफ स्कूल हैं, इनकी संख्या और ज्यादा बढ़ने वाली है, डबल हो सकती है, 7 करोड़ बच्चे, ये ऑफिशियल डेटा है कि ये शिक्षा के दायरे से बाहर हो सकते हैं। और ये अगर बाहर हो सकते हैं तो उसके लिए क्या उपाय किए जाने चाहिए? भारत सरकार ने जो हाल में बजट पेश किया, रिसोर्स जो है एक बहुत ही महत्वपूर्ण पैमाना है सरकार के कमिटमेंट को देखने का, उसकी अकाउंटेबिलिटी को देखने का, क्योंकि बगैर रिसोर्स के आप शिक्षा को यूनिवर्सलाइज नहीं कर सकते और हमारे स्कूली व्यवस्था को दुरुस्त नहीं कर सकते। हमारे जो रिसोर्स जो अभी बजट पेश हुआ है, फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर ने एक प्री बजट कंसल्टेशन बुलाया था जिसमें हम लोगों ने आरटी फोरम ने अपना सबमिशन दिया और हमने शिक्षा के बजट को बढ़ाने की बात कही। 6% तो कभी हम नहीं उस लक्ष्य तक पहुंच पाए, लेकिन हमने ये जरूर, हम ये नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी भी 6% की बात कह रही है, तो हमने ये बात जरूर कहा था कि एडिशनल स्पेशल पैकेज दिया जाना चाहिए कोरोना के बाद। लेकिन सरकार ने, आप सबको मालूम है, मैं उस पर डिटेल में नहीं जाऊंगा, हमारे बहुत ही मूर्धन्य वक्ता है इस वेबिनार में बोलने वाले, काफी शिक्षा बड़े शिक्षाविद हैं, शिक्षा के क्षेत्र में काफी उनका नाम है, वो लोग अपनी बात रखेंगे। लेकिन सरकार ने तरफ राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट को इनएफेक्टिव बनाने का नेशनल एजुकेशन पॉलिसी के जरिए प्रयास किया और दूसरी तरफ जो थोड़ी बहुत संभावना थी उसको बजट में भी समाप्त करने की कोशिश की, जिसका उन्होंने मुकाबले 7,000 करोड़ का कट किया है, स्कूली शिक्षा में, समग्र शिक्षा में 5,000 करोड़ कट हो गया, बढ़ाने के बजाय उसमें कटौती कर दी गई। अब ये जो स्कूल में बहुत सारे, आप जानते हैं कि लॉकडाउन की वजह से बहुत लोगों की नौकरियां चली गई और वो अपने बच्चों को प्राइवेट स्कूलों में नहीं भेज सकते, उसकी फीस अफोर्ड नहीं कर सकते, वो सब अगर सरकारी स्कूलों में वापस आएंगे तो सरकारी स्कूलों की व्यवस्था को दुरुस्त करने के लिए पैसों की जरूरत है और सरकार ने शिक्षा पर पैसे देने से मना कर दिया। तो इसलिए हम चाहते हैं कि ये जो शिक्षा अधिकार कानून है ये आज पहले से भी ज्यादा रेलेवेंट हो गया है, बच्चों के लिए एक जस्टिसिएबल राइट है जिसको पार्लियामेंट ने उन्हें दिया है, संविधान ने उन्हें दिया है, और इस अधिकार को एक्सरसाइज करने के लिए देश की ज्यादा आवाज आज के दिन किया जाना चाहिए कि यह अधिकार कोई खैरात नहीं है, ये अधिकार कोई भीख नहीं है, ये अधिकार सैकड़ों साल की लड़ाई के बाद देश की जनता को हासिल हुआ है, ये अधिकार आजादी के पहले और आजादी के बाद शिक्षा को एक देश के विकास या राष्ट्र के विकास में एक महत्वपूर्ण कंपोनेंट के बतौर देखते हुए इस अधिकार की मांग उठती रही है और इसलिए उस लड़ाई के बाद इस अधिकार को हासिल किया गया है। तो आज फिर से हम रिक्लेम करना चाहते हैं शिक्षा के अधिकार कानून को, आरटी एक्ट को, उसको मजबूत करने के लिए, और हम ये बात उठाना चाहते हैं कि भारत सरकार शिक्षा अधिकार कानून को 100% लागू करे और उसमें प्री प्राइमरी से और सेकेंडरी एजुकेशन को जोड़ के पूरे स्कूल एजुकेशन को एक अधिकार के रूप में सामने लाए, SDG 4 के लक्ष्यों को हासिल किया जा सके, रिसोर्सेज में बढ़ोतरी की जाए और 6% तक पहुंचने के लिए एक टाइम बाउंड प्लान का ऐलान किया जाए। दूसरा, प्राइवेट स्कूल्स जो बहुत तेजी के साथ बढ़ रहे हैं, और ये प्राइवेट स्कूल अब लो कॉस्ट नहीं, ये महंगे प्राइवेट स्कूल्स बढ़ रहे हैं, बल्कि शिक्षा के सिस्टम के बाहर भी और सिस्टम के अंदर भी प्राइवेटाइजेशन का एक बहुत बड़ा अभियान सा चल पड़ा है, और अभी आपने देखा होगा वर्ल्ड बैंक के पैसे से स्टार परियोजना भी शुरू हो रही है शिक्षा के अंदर। तो प्राइवेट स्कूल्स के लिए एक रेगुलेशन बनाया जाना चाहिए, ट्रेन टीचर्स की नियुक्ति हो, कोई कॉन्ट्रैक्ट टीचर नहीं और कोई लो पेड टीचर नहीं होना चाहिए, शिक्षकों के को शिक्षा के अलावा अन्य कामों से अलग रखा जाए, क्योंकि शिक्षा की गुणवत्ता एक बड़ा भारी चैलेंज है। आप सब जानते हैं कि देश के अंदर छोटे स्कूलों को बंद किया जा रहा है, 1.5 लाख स्कूल, सरकारी स्कूल इसलिए बंद कर दिए गए क्योंकि वहां बच्चों की संख्या कम है, और इसकी वजह से राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट का वायलेशन हुआ है, क्योंकि जो स्कूल मर्जर हो रहे हैं, जो स्कूल कंसोलिडेशन हो रहा है, जिसमें एनईपी में भी सुझाव रखा गया स्कूल कॉम्प्लेक्स के अंदर, उससे ड्रॉपआउट बढ़ने का खतरा है, निरक्षरता बढ़ने का खतरा है। इसलिए ये जो आरटी एक्ट ने जो 1 किलोमीटर और 3 किलोमीटर का प्रावधान रखा है प्राइमरी और अपर प्राइमरी का, मर्जर करते वक्त इस बात का ध्यान रखा जाना चाहिए कि इस कानून के प्रावधान का वायलेशन न हो। दूसरा, नो डिटेंशन को बहाल करके कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव कंटिन्यूस इवेल्युएशन को लागू किया जाए। और तीसरा ये कि स्कूल मैनेजमेंट कमिटीज को मजबूत करके एक सशक्त कम्युनिटी इंटरवेंशन का जो प्रावधान आरटी ने प्रपोज किया है उसको मजबूत किया जाना चाहिए। इन बातों को फिर से हम लाते हैं आज के दिन और इन सवालों को लेकर आने वाले दिनों में एक बड़ी मुहिम को चलाया जाएगा। और ये जो स्कूल मर्जर हो रहा है, कंसोलिडेशन हो रहा है, नाम पर स्कूल बंद किए जा रहे हैं, इसको रोका जाए। इन्हीं सब बातों के साथ मैं आप सब का स्वागत करता हूं हमारे पैनल में। आप जानते हैं प्रोफेसर मुचकुंद दुबे जो हमारे पूरे आंदोलन के मेंटर हैं और बहुत ही शुरू से इस आंदोलन को मार्गदर्शन देते रहे हैं। प्रोफेसर गोविंदा नीपा के वाइस चांसलर, पूर्व वाइस चांसलर और काउंसिल फॉर सोशल डेवलपमेंट के डिस्टिंग्विश्ड प्रोफेसर हैं। और प्रोफेसर गोविंदा उन लोगों में से रहे हैं जो ड्राफ्टिंग कमेटी में रहे हैं, जो इस कानून को लाने वाले लोगों में से रहे हैं। वो आज हमारे बीच में अपनी बात रखेंगे। प्रोफेसर अनीता रामपाल जी के बारे में हम सब जानते हैं। वो एक बहुत ही डीन रही हैं दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में शिक्षा एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट की, और वो एक एक्टिविस्ट भी रही हैं और आरटी फोरम के साथ लगातार शुरू से आरटी फोरम वजूद में आया है वो हमारे साथ मिलकर संघर्ष करती रही हैं। फरहान नकवी जी एक मानी जानी जर्नलिस्ट हैं और एक्टिविस्ट हैं, राइटर हैं, और वो बहुत ही माइनॉरिटीज के लिए और ऑप्रेस्ड क्लासेस के लिए काफी काम करती रही हैं। और इस पूरे सत्र को मॉडरेट करने के लिए हम लोगों की एक लोकप्रिय साथी एनी नाबला, जो हम लोगों के साथ शुरू से आरटी इस पूरे शिक्षा आंदोलन के साथ जुड़ी रही हैं, उसका नेतृत्व करती रही हैं, वो इस पूरे मॉडरेट करें। और आप सब से दरखास्त है कि अगर आपके कुछ सवाल हैं तो आप चैट बॉक्स में डालिए और एनी नामला जी उनको रेफर करेंगी और हमारे स्पीकर्स उस पर अपनी बात रखेंगे। और ये वो स्पीकर्स हैं जिन्होंने भारत में शिक्षा को यूनिवर्सलाइज करने के लिए न केवल लिखा है, न केवल वक्तव्य दिए हैं, बल्कि संघर्ष भी किया। मुझे याद है एक मॉडल एक्ट जब आया था तो उसकी कापियां हम लोगों ने जलाई थी जंतर मंतर पर, और हमने देखा कि उस जलाने वाले, अब मैं पता नहीं दुबे साहब को कैसा लगेगा, लेकिन मैंने देखा कि उस गैदरिंग में दुबे साहब भी खड़े थे कि ये जो है मॉडल रूल्स जो है ये ठीक नहीं है, देश के शिक्षा अधिकार कानून को लागू करने के लिए ठीक मॉडल रूल्स नहीं है। तो ये सब लोग एक्टिविस्ट भी रहे हैं, शिक्षाविद भी रहे हैं, समय समय पर सरकार की विभिन्न कमेटियों में भी रहे हैं, वो सब लोग आज आपके बीच में अपनी बात रखेंगे। तो इसी के साथ मैं आप सबको एक बार फिर से स्वागत करते हुए, इस ऐतिहासिक दिन पर आपका स्वागत करते हुए, मैं एनी नामला जी से अनुरोध करूंगा कि इस सत्र को आगे बढ़ाएं।
थैंक यू अमरीश जी और हमारी सभी साथियों को जो आई थिंक फ्रॉम अक्रॉस द कंट्री, अलग अलग स्टेट से सब लोग जो शिक्षा के ऊपर काम कर रहे हैं और जिनके लिए आरटी एक्ट एक इम्पोर्टेंट एक्ट है।
दिस विल बी बाइलिंगुअल एनी, दिस विल बी बाइलिंगुअल।
या ओके, सो वी हैव यू नो फ्रॉम अक्रॉस द स्टेट, अक्रॉस द कंट्री, आई थिंक यही शायद आरटी फोरम का स्ट्रेंथ है, दैट इट हैज हेल्प्ड ऑल ऑफ अस इन द एजुकेशन सेक्टर टू कम टुगेदर, whether it's academic people, activists, communities, and today फिर एक बार जब हम आरटी एक्ट की दिन की लेजिस्लेशन जो इनिशिएट हुआ और जो ग्राउंडिंग हुआ उसके बारे में जब हम सोच रहे हैं, when we are here together, I think it's again an opportunity and the need for us to really think, how do we get this act implemented? How do we get this act deepened, expanded, extended, so that har koi bacha ek right to free, compulsory, non-discriminatory, inclusive education tak hum pahunch payenge. So I think it is the four of us, we have very eminent speakers, Professor Dube, Professor Rampal, Professor Govinda, and Dr. Farah. Actually, I want to really say that I feel very privileged to be in your midst. We have huge respect and appreciation for all the work that you continue to do in the sector, and also for the cause of education in this country, to make this country an educated country. So we really look forward to your thoughts. And more than that, I also look forward to all our other members, jo har state mein apni tarike se shiksha ke upar kaam kar rahe hain. We also look forward to suggestions from you ki hum aage jaakar is act ko implementation plus आरपी एक्ट को एक रियलिटी बनाने के लिए हम कैसे कर सकते हैं आपकी सजेशंस. सो वी विल हैव फोर ऑफ आवर पैनल मेंबर्स टू स्पीक इनिशियली. ईच वन आई रिक्वेस्ट यू टू टेक अबाउट 15 मिनट्स टू शेयर योर थॉट्स ऑन हाउ वी कैन टेक द फोरम एंड द कैंपेन फॉरवर्ड एंड वील ओपन इट अप फॉर सजेशंस एंड रिकमेंडेशंस फ्रॉम अदर मेंबर्स टू. प्लीज पुट डाउन योर क्वेश्चंस एंड थॉट्स ऑन द चैट. And somewhere, even though after all the efforts of civil society, important eminent actors, the government passed the act in 2009 and 2010, somewhere we don't see the intention and a commitment to implement the act. So once again, we are back to maybe constitution assembly discussions. How do we make this a fundamental right for all our children? So it's a time to really think through this. Initially, I would request Professor Dube, who has been really an anchor and a mentor for PRTE Forum, and his thought on common school system and an equal quality education for all children has been one of the campaign agendas for the forum. Professor Dube, your thoughts with us first.
Thank you. Annie, it's really a privilege to participate in this webinar under your leadership and guidance. And I'm also very happy to see the face on the screen of some of your friends with whom I have worked very closely in the field of school education. I think, as Mr. Maris Rai pointed out, it's more than 10 years after the RTE Act was enacted. When it was enacted, it seemed to be the fulfillment of a dream cherished by millions of the citizens of the country. Aspired by another millions of children going to school for decades, if not centuries. What set the RTE Act apart from all other previous effort to provide school education was actually were two aspects of it. This I would call a paradigm shift in the whole approach and philosophy of school education in the country. One of them was that if you want to firstly, the goal of universalization for a very important sector of school education was accepted constitutionally and legally for the first time in the history of India. It had never been done before. It was accepted as a fundamental right by the amendment of the Constitution and the provision of Article 21A. And then the RTA Act made it, you know, converted into a law, which can be justiciable by our law courts, and which can enable parents and children to go to knock at the door of the courts to claim their right for free and compulsory education. So converting it into a legal right. Now these two things are such that has never happened in the history of the country. This happened for the first time. And people don't realize the significance of it. It has not been conveyed effectively in a proper manner to the vast majority of the people of the country. Because to have this kind of approach is the only way of universalizing school education. The other thing that was implicit in the act was that the country decided to act on all the variables of providing compulsory education simultaneously. Not that you take up some and ignore others, and then you drop the one which you are working and start on some again, which has been the pattern throughout our effort to provide school education to our children. So for the first time, country adopted the approach of acting simultaneously in all the variables, building all the schools that have to be built, recruiting all the teachers that have to be recruited, training the recruited teachers, ensuring other aspects of quality, bringing out of school children to school, and the whole host. I mean, you have to take the RTA Act one by one, and you will find the huge canvas on which the Act obliges the government to take action simultaneously and complete the exercise. And this is the second important point of the Act, which is a paradigm shift and which happened for the first time in the history of school education. And that was to attain universalized education within a time limit. Because as in the life of an individual, so in the life of a nation, you can't achieve a goal unless you set a target for that. If you just say that this is our goal, free and compulsory education, then you can go on, you know, indefinitely and giving excuses of one kind or the other of not being able to achieve the goal. So for the first time, there was a time limit. There was for 5 years within which to implement all the provisions of the Act. In other words, to implement the Act as such. Still, in other words, to universalize elementary education in India in 5 years. That was the, so these two distinguishing features set it apart from all other efforts that we have made in the country. Now, I think that I would not go into the positive features of the other positive features of the Act, some of which have been brought out by Ambarish, nor go into some of the very crippling deficiencies of the Act. I think that will take me too far from the main point that I want to convey. I think what happened is that after the new government came to power, there has been a shift of attention and focus from RT Act and from the notion of universalization, which is the essence of the RT Act, from the time frame, which is another essence, cardinal fact of the RT Act. From both these, there has been a departure in various ways made by the government, shifting the limelight from the RT Act, pushing it into background by other activities and by other policy measures. And I think first thing that has been noted is that after 2014, no important leader of the government, nor of the major political party constituting the government has really referred to the RT Act, reiterated his or her commitment to the Act, and indicated as to what measures he and or she are prepared to take for implementing the Act. This had not happened, you know, during this entire period of 7 to 8 years after this government has come to power. So this shows that they decided to be indifferent to it, to deliberately push it into the background, to deliberately shift attention from it. And therefore, they did not refer to it at the political level. They did not suggest measures. The Act had not apparently been implemented in the 5-year period. It was 2015. So one of the obvious things that one would have expected from the new government to go to the parliament to set a new deadline to implement it. This was never done. They did not even consider it. So this is one way in which they tried to scuttle it. The other thing that they did was that they set in motion the exercise of drafting the national education policy. Now, it was a long drawn out process, which took 5 to 6 years. And all these 5 and 6 years, nation's attentions got diverted to something which was, you know, sort of a pie in the sky, so to say, something which was in the nature of, you know, kind of a magical occurrence to happen in the country in the near future. And the country's attention got diverted to that. And well, after 5 years, the new education policy was announced. It was a big setback for those who supported the RT Act. There's no mention of the RT Act in the entire... In the entire new economic education policy, except at one place as historical narrative, the important landmarks that had happened, and there it is mentioned, but never in an operational sense as to what is wrong, what should be done, how it could be strengthened, implemented. There's nowhere this kind of element in the new economic policy. Secondly, many provisions of the new economic policy are in contradiction with the provisions of the RT Act. And they relate mainly to the role of and position of teachers, the notion of government's role and on financing, on the role of the private sector. All these things are contradictory to what is the approach of the RT Act and what is provided in the RT Act. I would not like to go into the details. These are obvious who have studied this subject. Thirdly, I think that the government adopted administrative measures which amounted to scuttling the RT Act, as so to say, by stealth. And two of such measures that I would like to mention was the closing down of the schools in the name of rationalization and in the name of implementing the RT Act, ironically, just the opposite of it. What was really happening was just the opposite of it. But this is the argument given by the government, that they are doing it to implement the RT Act. And secondly, this Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, I mean, this was an administrative fiat, but with far-reaching effect, because Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan combined three, you know, kind of disparate things, three different things. There is RT implementation, which is you earlier used to be done exclusively with the preserve of the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Secondary education, which is not the priority of the government, for which minimum resources are provided, and for which the government have already trying to absorb itself of the responsibility on the ground that it is too expensive and left it to the private sector. And so the meager resources devoted to Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan were combined with the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which in spite of limitations has a sizable amount of resources. And then with this, it was combined training of teachers. And one never knows which part of the budget is being diverted to what purpose. And this is another, I say, scuttling the RT Act by stealth, the thing done by the government. So I think this is what has happened in the course of the years. The new economic policy provides for structures, creation of institutions, which will drastically marginalize the RT Act. And for the operation and financing of which there is no provision in the new economic policy or in the budget. And there is no, it is just like the political kind of device of announcing high sounding measures, mainly of an institutional nature, even formally launching the institutions, though it may take another 20 years to establish it. And if you even establish the institution, then to ensure that it remains starved of funds and doesn't become effective at all or not fully effective. So this is this thing. The two other things that the government has done in the meantime, and which has seriously affected the RT Act. One is that not only the non-provision of adequate resources, which was not done by the earlier government also, but they definitely enhanced the given resources manifold and promised to continue to review the availability of resources. But this government, instead of that, has made two drastic cuts in the provision for education during the course of the 7 years that it has been in power. First in 2015 and 16, and the second in the 2021 and 22. In 15 and 16, the Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan budget was cut by 26%. Midday meals budget was cut by more than 30%. And the budget for the ICDS, which is the only flagship program and the only program of the government to look after the interest of the children below 6 years old, they reduced the budget provision for it by 49% in 2015 and 16. And in this budget, as has been pointed out, they have reduced the budget for school education by 5,000 crores, for education as a whole, 7,000 crores, and for newly defined ICDS, including some other provisions, by almost close to the percentage of 2015 and 16. Now, a government which makes this kind of drastic, arbitrary cuts in the budget for education, can it be taken seriously as regards its intention for providing free and compulsory education within a time-bound framework? What is it indicative of? That this goal, it is not happy with this goal, it is that does not suit its convenience, and it is adopting one means or the other to scuttle the goal. And lastly, I will point out that what this government has done, before I conclude, I'm going to conclude very soon because my time limit has come. Lastly, this government has proceeded at a pretty fast pace for privatizing school education, education as a whole, including school education. And this is being done by bringing the PPP mode for training teachers, for establishing new institutions provided in the new economic policy, and for several other things. Secondly, it has helped privatization by closing down the schools and allowing the private sector to build its own school at the place and the land on which the government school existed. And it's a general approach regarding government's role in the different sectors of the economy. A general approach on the whole question of education is a public good, an attempt to move away from the accountability that it has. And so these are all the measures by which the RTE Act has been tried to be pushed into the background, moderated, changed, some places beyond recognition, and scuttled. And I have given examples in each category. Now, where do we go from here? This is the issue. I think that the first and foremost thing that we should do is that we should not allow the government to do this thing with impunity. We don't want another voice. So we should try to compel the government to be accountable for what it is doing, to be accountable for what it has.
Hello. Baki log mute kar dijiye. Professor ji, if you can just conclude.
I'm concluding. I'm taking just 1 minute.
Yeah.
We should not allow the government to get away from its accountability in this regard. Thirdly, that we should continue our agitation for implementation of RTE Act through such meetings, through research, through publications, through media, through contact with parliamentarians. And lastly, we should, I have been saying for many years, we should knock at the door of the courts, because it is justiciable, and to see why it is not being implemented. And even beyond that, if necessary, waging a mass movement all over the country for keeping the RTE Act right in the center of the attention of the government and the nation, and ensuring its implementation within a revised time frame. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Dubey. You have very extensively highlighted many of the points, and I think these are concerns that all of us have. दो तीन विषय जो आपने हाईलाइट किया है, I feel that is something which we as a forum can take it forward and may will help us in our campaign and movement ahead. I think first of all we recognize that this is really the demand of the people. A proper quality education is a demand of the people. And people have been expressing this demand in many ways. As a forum, we are highlighting this demand of the people. Aur bachchon ka bhi ab ek dream ban gaya hai. Hum is COVID time mein hum bahut sari instances aise sune hain jahan par bachche bina phone ke, bina laptop ke, how they have even attempted to take away their lives because they're not able to study. So I think as a forum, we have to continue to give voice to the demand and dreams of the people. Secondly, jaise aapne kiya hai, the act and the fundamental right continues, whether the NEP comes or something else comes. The act is there. It has not been moved out. The fundamental right is there. Has not been removed. So we as a forum have every legitimate right to insist that this fundamental right and act is implemented. I think that mass movement, the campaign, the struggle for it, we do have a very good background for that. And we find national education policies or baki jitni policies aa rahe hain, they are only ways to delay and dilute the act and its implementation. So I think as a forum, 10 years over, 11 years over, what you have said in terms of a mass movement, continued work on this, I think it's very relevant. And all of us who are here, 200 plus people in every state, I think as a forum, we really have the responsibility to push this act and its provisions ahead. Thank you so much, Dubeji, for your thoughts and for the strategies. We really look forward to members of the forum to take this forward with us. I'd request now Anita Rampalji. She's been professor with Delhi University, Faculty of Education. And more than that, she's been one among us as an activist, as somebody who's worked on the act, who's been pushing the act, has worked in distant areas with communities to look at how the act can be implemented. Continuously, your commitment and your conviction about the act, Anita ji, we would really look forward to what you think we can do as a forum together to take this act to be implemented. Thank you so much and look forward to your thoughts. We'll keep around 15 minutes, Anita ji, for your thoughts.
Thank you, Annie. Sathyo, ye saal बहुत भयंकर रहा है. दिस रियली हैज बीन एन अनप्रेसिडेंटेड ईयर फॉर ऑल ऑफ अस एंड स्पेशली फॉर दोज वर्किंग इन एजुकेशन. आई एम सेइंग दिस बिकॉज मेनी थिंग्स हैव कम इन व्हिच ऑलमोस्ट सीम मेजर हर्डल्स एंड प्रोबेबली परमानेंट वेज ऑफ ट्राइंग टू स्टॉप द वर्क दैट वी हैव बीन डूइंग. मैं दो बच्चों का जिक्र करती हूँ. एक
ma'am, if you can give me just 1 minute, I'll just mute everyone.
Please, sir. Baki log.
Ma'am, I've just sent you a request to unmute yourself. You will see a request on your screen.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, yes, please go ahead.
Yeah. So I'm talking of just trying to remind ourselves symbolically through the narrative around two children. Very recently, what we have seen, 12-year-old Jamalo Makdam, she, for the first time, I mean, locked down completely, parents don't have any livelihood, nothing to eat. And with a few women of her village from Chhattisgarh, she walks down to a chili farm in Telangana for work. So children forced to actually go and work and get wages for their family and for food. Suddenly the lockdown comes in, no transport, no travel, no food, nothing, complete clampdown. They have no other choice, but they walk back through the forest for 3 days, more than 150 kilometers. And just a few kilometers from home, she dies. She falls, she dies, she collapses. And the doctor says, electrolyte imbalance. And, you know, so that's it. So this is one child, 12-year-old, whom we know where she should have been. Another child, just 2 weeks back, 14-year-old Habib, Ghaziabad, very close to a city like Delhi, where we talk about all these things. What happens? He's gone to work with his father. On the way, he sees a place where he wants to drink water. It happens to be a temple. A 23-year-old Shringi comes out. He beats him. He stops him from having water. He bashes him, thrashes him. Not just that, as has been reported, he calls his aide and tells him, ये इस फोटो में इस वीडियो में सबके दोनों के चेहरे दिखने चाहिए. So it is being done to actually put it out as an example in the public. He beats him on his private parts. And you know, this child says, I don't know how to read. Had I known how to read, I might have been able to see this notice board. But that's not the question. So ये इस बच्चे को तो 14 साल के बच्चे को स्कूल में ही होना चाहिए था, पर वो किस तरह की शिक्षा की हम बात कर रहे हैं? वो कैसा संविधान, वो कैसा देश, क्या हमारे सामने विजन है? What have we been trying to struggle for? I still remember the parliamentary debates, जब ये राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट को पास किया जाना था, उससे पहले जिस तरह की संविधान में बहस हम सुन रहे थे. और उतनी गहरी नहीं थी, उतनी सघन नहीं थी as we had expected, but still some parliamentarians, when they were trying to say why education has to be a fundamental right, they were looking at a larger canvas. They were looking at what education means to our lives, what education means to our vision of a nation, what it means to equity, what it means to fraternity. और जिस संविधान ने हमारे देश को बनाया और हमें वोट करने का हक दिया है, उसने शिक्षा के लिए क्या हमारे सामने चुनौती रखी है. बट टुडे विद व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन द लास्ट वन ईयर, स्कूल तो बंद हुए क्योंकि कोविड था, बीमारी थी, सही है, बच्चों को भी बचाना था, बड़ों को भी. बट उसके साथ क्या हुआ वो ज्यादा खतरनाक हुआ. The education system decided it could go online and carry on business as usual. NCERT ne ek curriculum nikala jisme kaha ke everyone in India has a phone. To wo kis India ki baat kar rahi thi NCERT? Aur ye kaha ke jiske paas smartphone nahi hai, they can send SMS it. And unhone jo curriculum nikala wo hasyaspad hai. If we look at that curriculum, what it talks about the chapter on equity, on equality. It talks about the constitution. It almost saddens us to see that in this last year, this is the concept of what online education can be. They tell children, they tell parents that you can download SMSs, you can download, tell children to download these ideas and then to write. There is a task which tells children, make a comic strip about the inequities that you find around you. Write an essay about equity and girls' participation, women's participation as a principle for democracy. हम उनको ये essay लिखने को कह रहे थे जब करोड़ों लोग millions of people were on the roads. Their children were being dragged on suitcases. Their children were dying while walking. They were being dislocated. कोई मिड डे मील नहीं, कोई स्कूल नहीं, और ये हम कह रहे हैं, अब हमारी एपेक्स बॉडी ये कह रही है. बट सबसे खतरनाक ये है कि दिस इज नाउ कमिंग. पिछले ही हफ्ते आई हैव हैड द अपॉर्चुनिटी टू लिसन टू एंड बी पार्ट ऑफ अ कंसल्टेंसी इन वन केस. राजस्थान के चीफ मिनिस्टर ने एक काउंसिल शुरू किया था, काउंसिल बनाया है, और उसके लिए एक कंसल्टेंसी में हमको कई लोगों को शिक्षा राइट टू एजुकेशन वाले हम कुछ 4-5 लोगों को बुलाया गया था. एंड द टाइटल ऑफ द नोट, वेरी स्केची नोट, सेड एक्विटी एंड इंक्लूजन. तो हमें कुछ थोड़ा सा, यू नो, वी फेल्ट अ लिटिल रीअश्योर्ड दैट राजस्थान इज टॉकिंग अबाउट एक्विटी एंड इंक्लूजन. बट वी वर शॉक्ड टू से that the person who was actually preparing for this consultancy was looking as digital education as the only option. He was talking of equity and inclusion only in terms of digital education. Aur ye ek apvaad nahi hai. Recently, I have met a chief secretary who has just been appointed in a state, and he said that they are not finding teachers, so now they are connecting all their schools to satellite television, and they are in a hurry. So they asked IIT Chennai to do it, and they said, nahi, kam se kam ek saal lagega satellite television har school mein pahunchane ke liye. So chief secretary ne kaha ki hum, we are doing it on our own because we have no time. I mean, they are not even listening. When I asked the question and said that if you don't have mathematics teachers, don't we need to prepare and find out how we are going to do that? Satellite television is not going to answer, but this is the model. In Delhi government also, in Delhi government schools, jab online classes chal rahi thi, we know less than 20% children, even from private schools, even from universities, 20 to 30 could actually access and participate. Aur hamare liye to ye elementary education ka koi model nahi hai. Online, chahe aap blackboard ko ghoor ke dekhen, or you stare at a phone or stare at a screen, this is not education. The RTE chapter 5 tells us what is the right of a child for what kind of education, what kind of explorations, discoveries, discussing different views and perspectives within the classroom, within the site of education is crucial for a democracy, and they are talking about that. But now in the COVID ke bahane, the government, as the NEP shows us, NEP mein pandemic ka shabd keval ek jagah aaya hai. Ye chapter 24 mein aaya hai jo online education ki baat kar rahi hai. Aur NEP ke aar mein ab everything is going to be shifted to online education. Wo mana ja raha hai. Universities mein ye maan rahi hai ki this is the option. We have to prepare for this. और कल ही बल्कि UGC ने एक यूनिवर्सिटी का एक नॉर्म निकाला है that 40% of an undergraduate course can be done by online courses. जिन कॉलेजेस में स्टूडेंट्स हैं उनको भी कह रहे कि आप उनको ऑनलाइन कोर्सेज करने दीजिए. सो दिस इज नाउ द मॉडल. यू डोंट नीड टीचर्स. यू कैन जस्ट द गवर्नमेंट कैन कंटिन्यू एंड से दैट वी आर डूइंग एजुकेशन under the name of online education. Aur ye kaun hai online education jinka business bahut bada hai? We know that all these coaching providers and service providers in the last 1 year, baki economy to bilkul niche giri, but the companies which had a major boost in India and across the world were education technology providers. So they are technology providers. It is not education as we are concerned. Dusra, what is happening in terms of even the children, the private agencies which are coming up? Ek taraf NEP ne keh diya hai ki jo school chote hain unko band kar do because they are suboptimal. So in December 10,000 schools in Odisha, 10,000 schools in Madhya Pradesh, many states in during this month they were closed down because they were tribal schools, so they were in remote habitations with very small populations. Par uske sath kya hua hai, जो बजट आई है, एक तरफ से तो बजट ने पैसा काटा है काफी ज्यादा, जो बहुत जरूरी था, और खासकर कोविड के बाद और भी ज्यादा फंड्स चाहिए थे, बट बजट ने पैसा कहाँ दिया है? सैनिक स्कूल्स. So we know that what kind of an agenda is being pushed. वो क्या militaristic, authoritarian, majoritarian एक समझ है जो कि private agencies के साथ सैनिक स्कूलों को बढ़ावा और नवोदय विद्यालय के मॉडल पर, but एकलव्य schools. एकलव्य schools, I have recently again heard from one state that they have offered it to private agencies, agencies who are clearly promoting a majoritarian religion. They have been offered Eklavya schools where the minimum funds from the government is 35 crore. And then you get the land and you get, and you start the school and you run it. So this is the other model that is now coming in, which we have seen. Close down these schools. Usi ke saath, aap tribal ilaqo mein hi kis tarah ke school shuru kar rahe hai. So, now the question now for us is ke NEP ne to RTE ko bilkul abandon kar diya hai. Annie keh rahi hai ke RTE hai, magar NEP keh raha hai ke RTE ki zarurat hi nahi hai, because NEP says that open school bhi class 3 mein chalega, sari testing, sare assessments centralized honge, curriculum jo hoga wo national banega, aur thoda sa chonk, some local flavor will be added by the states. So the whole centralized model is going to be pushed down. And not just that, ye jo ek naye investment bonds aa rahe hain, inme bhi ye log class 3 ke learning outcomes dekhenge, unke investment partners ko dikhane ke liye ki kahan invest kare kahan nahi kare. So ye jo learning outcomes ka hua hai, ye jo outcomes hain jo kehte hain ki inputs ki koi zarurat nahi hai, NEP says that. NEP says there will be no focus on inputs. So we know who is going to be pushed out. And 50% of children are being now said that they will be in vocational education, both in school and at college level. And vocational education mein education ke naam pe shunya hai. There is no education. There is only skills. There are only skills, a curriculum decided by the industry. And we are saying that jahan teacher nahi hai, wahan community members can come in. Wo kaun community members hain, wo kis agenda se aa rahe hain, kis samajh se aa rahe hain, is desh ki kya unke samne samajh hai jo wo aake schoolon mein unko khuli chhoot hai aane ke liye. So I think this for us now, it is not just a struggle for RTE, it is a struggle for the constitution. Because constitution के खिलाफ कई चीजें हुई हैं. Constitution में states अपनी policies बनाती हैं, पर यहाँ उनको वो भी छूट नहीं मिली है. And also it's a struggle for an idea of India, which gives an education to everyone, to Habib and to Shringi, to understand what does the constitution ensure, what does equity ensure, and that everyone has a right through an education to understand each other, not to propagate hatred. And we must really question this hatred. We should go to courts when we find that children are not getting the schools, their schools are being closed, or tribal children are getting further oppressed. I think this year for us is a major challenge. And I just want to close here saying that the 11th year of the RTE almost opens up many more challenges before us beyond RTE. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita ji. I think jo aapko sunkar, I think you know, the kind of concern and desperate place we are in, it's really very evident. And एक तरीके से देखें तो RTE had one particular direction and approach from the country in relation to the constitution, and what we today have as national education policy or other policies is a totally different approach and a different direction. So I think we see the two divergence. Certainly the national education policy is not in keeping with the RTE framework, and so we see a completely different direction and approach that the government is taking in terms of the education and the way education will go forward. And all of us who recognize that this country's 70% of children, 80% of children need the government to implement the right to education for them to be educated and for the country to be educated. I think that's very clear to all of us. Itni sari knowledge aur itni sari issues ko rakh kar bhi sarkar jab apni tarika se education dena chahte hain, it really is a reflection of what the government is planning to do. And I think that's where really the RPE forum and all of us parents, children have to come forward to continue to demand in whatever way that we can continue to demand RPE as a right of every child. I think, we are extremely distressed. We all know, but to hear it again is really something that distresses all of us working in the sector. So thank you for once again bringing the big challenges that we face today and to work towards something that we can work together on this whole agenda. So we will take questions. I can see some questions that are already there in the chat box, but after the other two speakers, I would request Professor Govinda to bring his thoughts. He's also been someone that we are all very familiar with and been one of the advocates for an equitable quality education and evidence-based, planning and entitlements that we need to work in education. So thank you, Govindaji, for being with us.
Thank you.
Look forward to your thoughts. And it's about 15 minutes of time.
Dubey sahab aur Anita ji ne kafi mudda aapke hamare samne already rakha hai. Main isko repeat nahi karunga. Aaj jo kaha ki 11 साल हुई अप्रैल 10, 2010 में इसको रिलीज किया था, शुरू किया था, ये आरटी एक्ट ऑपरेशनलाइज किया. अभी 11 साल हो गई और 11 साल में जो हुआ है वो तो हमारे सबके सामने है. जो अम्बरीश जी ने कहा कि तभी भी कह रहे थे कि 2011 में भी हम कह रहे थे कि सिर्फ 12% स्कूल ऐसे है कि जो आरटीई कंप्लेंट है, और आज भी वही कह रहे हैं अनफॉर्चुनेटली. तो ये दिस गिव्स एन आइडिया इन टर्म्स ऑफ व्हाट वी हैव डन और व्हाट वी हैव नॉट डन. मैं ये कहना चाहता हूँ कि दिस इज 11 ईयर ओल्ड द आरटीई एक्ट, लेकिन जो हमारा संघर्ष, हमारा जो लड़ाई है कि सबके लिए शिक्षा होना चाहिए, ये शिक्षा की लड़ाई तो 110 साल पहले शुरू हुई है. जब ही गोपाल कृष्ण गोखले ने इंपीरियल असेंबली में एक कंपलसरी एजुकेशन एक्ट का बिल पेश किया तभी शुरू हुई. लेकिन हम सभी जानते हैं कि ब्रिटिश रूलर्स जो थे, इनको भारतीय बच्चों का शिक्षा देने में कोई दिलचस्पी नहीं थी, इन लोगों ने कुछ किया नहीं ठीक से. कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन जब ही बना तभी जरूर इसको कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में इंक्लूड किया. कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में दूसरा कोई भी सेक्शन में टाइम लिमिट नहीं लिखा, सिर्फ एक ही क्लॉज में लिखा है टाइम लिमिट, वो है कि एजुकेशन, प्राइमरी एजुकेशन का. इट्स अ वेरी अनयूजुअल थिंग इन अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन टू एज इफ इट इज अ प्रोजेक्ट टू बी कंप्लीटेड दैट अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल प्रोविजन से दैट विद इन 10 ईयर्स इट हैज टू बी अचीव्ड. दैट इज द काइंड ऑफ इंपॉर्टेंस, अर्जेंसी दैट वॉज अटैच टू दिस. हम जानते हैं 10 साल हो गए वो काम नहीं हुआ. जब ही कोठारी कमीशन को बिठाया, कोठारी कमीशन ने 1965-66 में कहा कि इसके लिए तो और भी टाइम लगेगी और 20 साल में पूरा हो जाएगा. तो इसके मतलब 1985 तक यूनिवर्सल एलिमेंट्री एजुकेशन हो जाना चाहिए. 1985 भी आ गई तभी नहीं हुआ. 1986 में पॉलिसी लेकर आए. पॉलिसी तो वो सभी पुरानी जो एक्सपीरियंस थी वो सभी तो साइड में रख दिया. पॉलिसी ने कहा कि कोई बात नहीं, हम तो ये शताब्दी के अंत तक पूरा कर देंगे, बिफोर 2000 इट विल बी अचीव्ड. लेकिन 2000 भी हो गए तभी भी नहीं हुआ. और बाद में हम लेकर आए सबसे बड़ा प्रोजेक्ट देश में, वो सर्वशिक्षा अभियान आई 2000 में. और साथ साथ में जो हमने जो आरटीई फोरम और सभी मिलके नफरे सभी ने संघर्ष जो चालू किया था इसकी वजह से, और उन्नीकृष्णन जजमेंट के वजह से पार्लियामेंट में अमेंडमेंट किया और ये आरटीई एक्ट लेकर आए. देखिए आरटीई एक्ट तो 50 साल के बाद जो आर्टिकल 45 थी डायरेक्टिव प्रिंसिपल को कन्वर्ट किया फंडामेंटल राइट. इसमें ये एक वस्तु है जो दुबे साहब ने ऑलरेडी हमारे सामने रखा कि ये जो फंडामेंटल राइट बनाना बहुत वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यू इट इज, क्योंकि 1950 में कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बना तभी क्यों नहीं फंडामेंटल राइट बनाया, ऐसा नहीं, इसके बारे में बहुत चर्चा हुई, फंडामेंटल राइट्स कमिटी में भी चर्चा हुई, सब कमिटी में और कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली में भी चर्चा हुई, लेकिन तभी माना लोगों ने कि हमारे देश में अभी भी आर्थिक क्षमता नहीं है कि सभी बच्चों को एक साथ में लेकर आए, सभी को स्कूल खोल के रख इनको एडमिट करें, इतना हमारे पास हमारे क्षमता नहीं है, इसीलिए नहीं किया था 1950 में। इसकी मतलब यह है कि जब 2002 में हम फंडामेंटल राइट कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल अमेंडमेंट किया, गवर्नमेंट देयरफॉर एक्सेप्टेड दैट टुडे वी आर इकोनॉमिकली केपेबल ऑफ प्रोवाइडिंग एजुकेशन फॉर ऑल चिल्ड्रन इन अ लिमिटेड टाइम फ्रेम विच कुड नॉट बी डन इन 1950। दिस इज एन इम्प्लीकेशन ऑफ फंडामेंटल राइट, एंड देयर वाज वी ऑल थॉट दैट यू नो इट विल बी डन इन 5 years, लेकिन हम जानते हैं कि 2002 में अमेंडमेंट हुई लेकिन इसको लागू नहीं किया, इसको आरटीई एक्ट ही नहीं बना, आरटीई एक्ट बना और बहुत सारा इसको इधर उधर किया, मॉडल एक्ट लाया, सब कुछ किया, फाइनली 2009 में बहुत लड़ाई के बाद इतना संघर्ष करना पड़ा, बाद में 2009 में एक्ट पास हुई, बाद में और 6 महीने लगा, अगस्त में हुई 2009 में और भी टाइम लगा, बाद में 2010 में ये लेकर आए, बाद में तो हम जानते हैं कि 3 साल तक रिपोर्ट भी लेकर आए, हर साल एक रिपोर्ट रखते थे देश के सामने लोगों के सामने कि आरटीई एक्ट के मुताबिक क्या हुआ क्या नहीं हुआ, 3 साल के बाद वो रिपोर्ट करना ही बंद कर दिया गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने, और 2014 के बाद तो हम जानते हैं कि प्लानिंग करना ही बंद कर दिया है, वो बताएंगे नहीं कब होना चाहिए, दुबे साहब ने कहा कि 5 साल का आउटर लिमिट रखा था, 5 साल के अंदर अंदर हो जाना चाहिए, हम सब लोगों ने बहुत उत्साह थे कि इतने सालों की जो लड़ाई हुई अभी 5 साल के अंदर पूरा होना चाहिए, क्योंकि ये फंडामेंटल राइट का एक एक्ट है, ये तो ऑर्डिनरी लेजिस्लेशन नहीं है, ये तो फंडामेंटल राइट है, इसमें जरूर हो जाएगा ऐसा आशा थी, लेकिन 5 साल तो आके चले गए और कुछ हुआ ही नहीं, जैसा था वैसा ही रखा है अभी भी। और एक इस बीच में ये भी हुई कि जो ये भी दुबे साहब ने कहा कि ये एक स्कीम के मुताबिक नहीं हो सकता है, इसको तो प्रोग्राम करना चाहिए, दिस वाज एक्चुअली सेट बाय अ कमिटी दैट द गवर्नमेंट सेट अप आल्सो, व्हिच सेड दैट यू नो यू कैन नॉट ऑपरेशनलाइज राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट थ्रू ए स्कीम called Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, you have to do it through a program. The program has to be All India program. Every state should really embrace this and then really do it. Lekin humne, the government ne decide kiya ki SSCA will be the main vehicle. To isme do problem ye hui. Tab tak kya tha ki hum state government ko kehte the aapki responsibility the. To RTE Act aane ke baad wo kehte hain RTE Act to central act hai. गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया को करना चाहिए, और इसके साथ साथ में SSCA has occupied all the space related to primary education. प्रोग्राम तो SSCA में बनता है, पैसा कितना होना चाहिए SSCA में सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट डिसाइड करती है, इसकी वजह से स्टेट गवर्नमेंट का जो इनिशिएटिव था वो भी सभी बंद हो गया इस बीच में, और हम अभी ऐसी परिस्थिति में आए हैं कि जो 1 साल से स्कूल भी बंद है, और हम तो नेशनल पॉलिसी भी अनाउंस कर दिया, स्कूल बंद रखा लेकिन पॉलिसी तो अनाउंस कर दिया, पॉलिसी लागू करने के लिए कोई स्कूल का जरूरत नहीं लगता है मुझे तो, ऐसा सोचना होगा इनका, पता नहीं कैसा पॉलिसी कर दिया। मैं ये इसीलिए इतना सारा कहना चाहता हूं कि 25 साल पहले हमने कहा, हम आप स्टैटिस्टिक्स देखिए, 25 साल पहले जब EDP पे शुरू हुई तभी कहा था हमारा देश में सिर्फ 2% बच्चों के लिए वॉकिंग डिस्टेंस में स्कूल नहीं है, 1 किलोमीटर 2 किलोमीटर 1.5 किलोमीटर के अंदर नहीं है, सिर्फ 2% के लिए, 98% चिल्ड्रन हैव एक्सेस टू स्कूल विद इन ए वॉकिंग डिस्टेंस। ये तब की स्टैटिस्टिक्स थी, तभी कितने स्कूल थे, 8 लाख स्कूल थे, अभी कितना स्कूल है, अभी 15 लाख स्कूल है, दुगुना कर दिया, 2% के लिए क्या, मुझे समझ में ही नहीं आ रहा है। तो कि इसको दुगना हो गया, लेकिन जितने बच्चे बाहर थे इतना बच्चे अभी भी बाहर है और इससे ज्यादा बच्चे बाहर हैं शायद अभी। तो इतना स्कूल खोला, सभी स्कूल छोटे छोटे स्कूल ईजीएस में, अल्टरनेट स्कूल में और कॉन्ट्रैक्ट टीचर्स का स्कूल, सब तरफ का स्कूल खोल दिया, बच्चों को वहां बिठा दिया। अब कह रहे कि नहीं ये सब भी स्कूल बंद कर दो, बच्चे कहाँ जाएंगे? ये हम तो तुगलक जो हमने सुना है ना हिस्ट्री में, तुगलक राज्यभार ऐसा हो रहा है ये तो, कि पहले जहां जरूरत नहीं था अभी खोलो, अभी बंद करो। तो आई थिंक यू नो वी नीड प्रॉपर प्लानिंग व्हेन वी आर सेइंग दैट वी वांट टू रिक्लेम आरटीई। इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी शुड रिटर्न टू द प्लानिंग टेबल, वर्क सिस्टमैटिकली, देन ओनली इट कैन हैपन। एंड अनफॉर्चुनेटली एज ऑल ऑफ देम हैव सेड ऑलरेडी, तो ये एनईपी में तो इसको रेफरेंस ही नहीं किया। हमारा लड़ाई जो है सिर्फ सभी बच्चों के लिए एक स्कूल खोलने की बात नहीं है, सभी बच्चों के लिए समान शिक्षा की बात है ये तो। बिकॉज द बिगिनिंग इफ यू लुक एट द पर्पस ऑफ द ऑब्जेक्ट ऑफ द एक्ट व्हेन इट वाज मूव्ड इन द पार्लियामेंट, इट सेज वेरी क्लियरली इट द अंडरलाइंग प्रिंसिपल इज ऑफ इक्वालिटी एंड सोशल जस्टिस। सभी को समान शिक्षा मिलना चाहिए। हम जानते हैं किसको नहीं मिल रहा है बच्चे, ऐसा नहीं है कि हमें पता नहीं है किसको नहीं मिल रहा है। हम जानते हैं जो वंचित बच्चे शेड्यूल कास्ट के, शेड्यूल ट्राइब के हैं, माइनॉरिटीज के हैं, ये सभी हम जानते हैं, लेकिन किया क्या? 25 साल पहले जो था अभी भी वही लोग हैं, वंचित हैं। 25 साल पहले हम कह रहे थे कि ये 5-6 और ये 7-8 राज्य है वहां ज्यादा प्रॉब्लम है, आज भी वही राज्य सामने उठकर आती है कि वहां प्रॉब्लम है। हम कर रहे हैं क्या है? वो एक कैसे सुधारेंगे ये यूनिवर्सल एलिमेंट्री एजुकेशन लाएंगे? हम प्लानिंग ही नहीं करना चाहते हैं। अभी 7 साल से तो हमने प्लानिंग बंद कर दिया, हम सोचते ही नहीं है। तो मेरे ख्याल से अभी इम्पॉर्टेंट है कि हमें फिर से एक आंदोलन शुरू करना चाहिए। मैं जानता हूं कि आंदोलन ये शब्द अच्छे नहीं है आजकल, आंदोलन की बात करने से तो हम राष्ट्रद्रोही बन जाते हैं, कोई बात नहीं, लेकिन आंदोलन तो आंदोलन आंदोलन होता ही है, हमें छेड़ना है आंदोलन। तो ये जो शिक्षा के जो 1998-99 में हमने जो छेड़ा था, ऐसा फिर से हमें करना पड़ेगा, पूरा देश में चलाना पड़ेगा ये संघर्ष। सिर्फ हम एक रिपोर्ट लिखने से नहीं होता है, अभी तक तो सिर्फ आरटीई रिपोर्ट लेकर आई, हर साल लेकर आती है कि देश के सामने रखती है कि कहाँ कितना स्कूल है, कितने वंचित हैं, सब कुछ रखते हैं। लेकिन मुझे लगता है कि इससे आगे बढ़ना चाहिए, हमें दबाव लाना चाहिए गवर्नमेंट के ऊपर, क्योंकि गवर्नमेंट की जिम्मेदारी है, गवर्नमेंट के ऊपर। सिर्फ ये नहीं है कि 12% स्कूल में कंप्लेंट्स है, इसको बढ़ाओ, हम तो कह के आए वो लोगों ने नहीं किया। इसके लिए दूसरा जो व्यवस्था किया था, जो आरटी एक्ट में जो व्यवस्था किया था, इसको वापस लेकर आना चाहिए। मेरे ख्याल से मैं 2-3 मुद्दा रखना चाहता हूँ, हम डिस्कस कर सकते हैं क्या करना चाहिए आगे। एक तो मैं हमारा डिमांड होना चाहिए, अभी 11 साल हो गए गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक वाइट पेपर निकाले आरटीई एक्ट का परिस्थिति क्या है और इसको पार्लियामेंट में पेश करके डिस्कस करें। ये अजीब सा है हमारा देश में कि पार्लियामेंट भी कोई डिस्कस नहीं करती है। पार्लियामेंट में अमेंडमेंट किया, एक्ट बनाया, फंडामेंटल राइट किया, इसका एक्ट बनाया, अभी 11 साल में ऐसा कोई अच्छे डिस्कशन ही नहीं हुई इसके बारे में। अमेंडमेंट होती आई है लेकिन डिस्कशन नहीं हुई। सो मेरा फर्स्ट सजेशन ये है कि हमें डिमांड करना चाहिए गवर्नमेंट से, एक कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव व्हाइट पेपर निकालें और इसको प्रेजेंट करें और पार्लियामेंट में डिस्कस हो कि 11 साल पहले जो एक्ट आया इसका परिस्थिति क्या है, आज किस परिस्थिति में है। दूसरी ये है कि जो एनुअल रिपोर्ट निकालते थे, हमें इंसिस्ट करना चाहिए गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया, इट इज अ सेंट्रल एक्ट that has been there, and government of India has a responsibility to tell the people what is happening according to the act. And so we need to bring back the idea of an annual report, and that should be shared with the parliament. This is the second point. Third point is that in order to really ensure that it goes in the right direction, RTE mein hi hai ke national advisory committee hona chahiye. आरटीई के एक्ट के अंदर है नेशनल एडवाइजरी कमेटी का रेफरेंस, और पहले 3-4 साल तो एडवाइजरी कमेटी भी चलाया, लेकिन बाद में तो एडवाइजरी कमेटी भी बंद कर दिया, अभी इसको भी अबंडन कर दिया है। हमें कहना चाहिए कि वापस लाओ नेशनल एडवाइजरी कमेटी, किसी को तो गवर्नमेंट हैज टू आंसर समबडी व्हाट इज हैपनिंग, गवर्नमेंट हैज टू बी टोल्ड व्हाट दे शुड बी डूइंग, नथिंग इज हैपनिंग। सो दैट इज द थर्ड पॉइंट आई वांट टू से। फोर्थ इज दैट जब ही ओरिजिनल जो हमने बनाया था राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट, इसमें सजेस्ट किया था कि एक नेशनल एलिमेंट्री एजुकेशन कमीशन होना चाहिए इसको सुपरवाइज करने के लिए, लेकिन वो इसका एक्सेप्ट नहीं किया, इसकी जगह में अग्री किया कि नेशनल ये जो एनसीपीसीआर है, एनसीपीसीआर को हम एम्पावर करेंगे और वो इसका मॉनिटर करेंगे आरटी एक्ट इम्प्लीमेंटेशन का। लेकिन अभी एनसीपीसीआर भी कुछ नहीं, इनके पास तो कोई नहीं है, इट इज अ डिसएम्पावर्ड कमीशन इट हैज बिकम इन फैक्ट, एंड नथिंग इज हैपनिंग। इनिशियली फॉर 2-3 years इन फैक्ट एनसीपीसीआर डिड समथिंग, बट नथिंग इज हैपनिंग नाउ। So I think, you know, since it is a part of the act, we need to insist that the government should come out with an idea in terms of how they are going to empower NCPCR, not just like any other commission, but with full powers, how NCPCR will monitor this. So last point I may kahana chahta hun, we need to really get a state level action plan prepared, not action plan of implementing RTE, wo nahi hai. वो तो इम्प्लीमेंटिंग आरटी है तो एसएसए प्लान बन जाएगा। तो हमें ये कहना चाहिए कि एक पर्सपेक्टिव प्लान, ठीक है हम केरला में तो कल भी हो जाएगा, ये तो हो गया कह सकते हैं, लेकिन वो कह सकते हैं कि बिहार में तो यूपी में तो इतना जल्दी नहीं हो सकता है, आप बनाओ कितने साल में हो सकता है, हमें लोगों को बताओ कि ठीक है बिहार में तो 8 साल लगेगा, 10 साल लगेगा, 15 साल लगेगा, कुछ तो कमिट करो। तो मेरा ख्याल से ये इंसिस्ट करना चाहिए हर एक स्टेट में एक प्लान बनाए, पर्सपेक्टिव प्लान बनाए, आरटी इम्प्लीमेंटेशन नहीं है, आरटी का जो हक जो एंटाइटलमेंट है और सभी बच्चों के लिए कब एंटाइटलमेंट मिलेगा, क्योंकि आरटी ऐसे फंडामेंटल राइट ऐसा है कि कुछ लोगों को मिलता है, इसे नहीं होता है, 98% भी ठीक नहीं है। तो फंडामेंटल राइट तो इंडिविजुअल राइट है, हर एक बच्चों को होना चाहिए। तो आप कमिट करो हर एक स्टेट में कब ये पहुंचेगा हर एक बच्चों को, और एक प्लान बना के हमारे सामने रखो। मेरे ख्याल से हमें आरटी की तरफ से ये सभी मुद्दा आगे लाना चाहिए, सभी के लिए बनाना चाहिए, और गवर्नमेंट से इंसिस्ट करना चाहिए, एक प्रेशर लाना चाहिए, लॉबी बनाना चाहिए, और पूरा देश में एक छेड़ना चाहिए संघर्ष। तो गवर्नमेंट अभी सो रहे हैं तो उठ के बैठे और सुने और कुछ करें। That's what I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Govinda. You once again energized us with some of your thoughts and ideas. And the fact that the forum में 200 लोग से ऊपर अब भी 1.5 घंटे के बाद भी they are continuing to listen also shows the kind of concern this issue brings to all of us. I think it's really something of a concern. And RTE Forum, Amrish Ji, and all of us have a full responsibility for taking these thoughts forward. I will only add to what your suggestions are, Professor, that we should stop now depending only on Governance Commission. Maybe we need a People's Commission on education in every state where we can put a perspective plan and say that as per the fundamental rights, this is the People's Commission to whom, you know, reports will be given, plans will be made. As a forum, we will be in the struggle and movement, but as a People's Commission, as a body that can really plan a perspective plan for this country and children, I think. Thank you so much. We have Farah with us. Farah Naqvi has been a writer and an activist. Her thoughts, particularly about the disadvantaged communities, children, issues that the country faces have, I think there have been really concerns that most of us have resonated with Farah. And you have been part of looking at a non-discrimination and inclusion in education, where you have really put down a lot of, recommendations, things around. So look forward to your thoughts on 11 years and how do we move forward.
Thank you so much, Annie. Bahut bahut shukriya. Dosto, sabko mera namaskar, sabko salam. I'm very grateful to the RTE Forum for inviting me here today. And to be with so many friends I haven't interacted with for a long time. You know, the right to education was a dream. And I am privileged to have known some of those who made it happen. Professor Govinda is here on your panel. People who were there in the drafting of it, in there in the spirit of it. Anita Rampal has already spoken. But I want to begin my remarks by paying a special tribute to three people, not because there are not others, but because they are people that one misses today when the Right to Education Act faces the kinds of challenges. Jis tarah ki chunautiyon ka byora aapne baki vaktaon se suna, main apni shradhanjali, ek to Vinod Raina. Vinod was a one-man army when it came to his commitment to the RTE. I also want to speak of Anil Bodia, and I want to speak of Anita Kaul. You know, Vinod, Bodia Saab and Anita, these are three people who are not with us today and were very, very instrumental. And we miss them for their unwavering commitment to education. And I want to start with a tribute to them and say, if they were here, what would they have been thinking and doing, whether in government or outside of government? It is a privilege to speak after so many fine speakers who are true experts in the area of education. Starting with Amrish Jaiji and moving on to all my other speakers on this panel. It is a privilege because I get to pick up from points that they have all made and make them my own and present them to you with a few added thoughts that I have today. So speaking most generally about the RTE, the campaign to reclaim the RTE, as Anita Rampal said already, the campaign to reclaim anything has to be seen in a larger socio-political context. I remember years ago when I was working on the issue of sex selection for the BBC World Service Trust, we were doing a project and I was preparing a media strategy. And I said, you know, we need to really focus on women's rights rather than on the rights of a girl fetus. And they said, why? I said, it's not the little fetuses they dislike. It's that girls grow up to be women. That's the problem. The problem is misogyny in India in all its forms. And likewise, so in RTE, it is not children's education or elementary education. It is the idea of education itself that is under challenge. So then our challenge has to be much, much graver than the implementation of the RTE law. You know, we are talking about a social political context in which we are seeing all signs of India becoming more and more anti-women. And this is, you know, when we talk about inclusion of girls in elementary education, if the entire context is becoming anti-women, and we see this today in the Global Gender Index, we've seen it very recently, India has slipped 28 places to rank 140 among 156 countries. This is the World Economic Forum's Global Gender Gap Report of 2021. India is the third worst performer in South Asia. What is going on? And in the context of this kind of discrimination against women, how do we then battle for inclusion of girls in elementary? That is bound to be affected. Likewise, you know, we are talking about a kind of a very, very Brahmanical majoritarianism that is anti-Dalit in its politics, in the violence. It is categorically anti-Muslim. We've seen that not only in violence, but in ideological declarations across. This is not something that we can deny anymore. It is anti-Christian. You saw what happens to the nuns recently in Jhansi on a train station. And it is anti-basic constitutional values. So when education is more and more and more becoming instrumental, and I'm tired of this phrase, demographic dividend, it is such an instrumental idea of education. When universities are sought to be sanitized of all democratic and free expression, how can elementary education remain a sanctuary of anything? So I believe that we have to locate the struggle to reclaim the RTE within the much larger political struggles for the freedom to think, the freedom to speak, free expression, equity, basic democratic values. Linked to that, let us not fetishize any law, the RTE included, because the RTE was not the end, it was a means to an end, right? The end was our vision of equity. And so when the house is crumbling all around us, schools will not be islands of equity or democracy or equality. So given the nature of that challenge, and there was something very interesting that Ambrish Ji said right in the beginning. He said it's been rolled out like a scheme, not like a right. And I heard Professor Govinda echoing that sentiment. I think, there is a lot in this moment in India's history where in many spheres of action, we are having to go back to the basics. And I think while we have for all of these 11 years focused rightfully on the RTE Act as a justiciable law, I think we have lost sight in our communication, in how it is seen in public discourse of Article 21A. And that is the fundamental right that is embedded in the Constitution in 2002, the 86th Amendment. Honestly, you talk to people in civil society, perhaps not those who work on RTE, you talk to human rights people, they can all tell you what Article 21 is. It's such a fundamental right. It's the right to life and personal liberty enshrined in our Constitution. But you ask them, what is Article 21A? And very few people can actually tell you what it is. It hasn't reached that level of being seen as a fundamental right. And we need to interrogate, why was it put under Article 21? Why did the right to education become a subsection of 21 and become Article 21A? Why? Because denial of that education then is a denial of a range of your basic citizenship, entitlements, your ability to access it. It leads to intergenerational stagnation and therefore the absence of communities upon communities to be partners in partaking of equal fruits of India's development. And I think we need to campaign around the idea of Article 21A to bring home even to, human rights people, for example, are concerned deeply with civil liberties. We're concerned with people wrongfully in jails. But the right to education does not enter the human rights discourse with that much gravity. And so therefore it remains at the level of a law and a scheme and does not acquire that consciousness of it being seen as a human rights violation when that one Jamal Makdam whom Anita mentioned and 20 other cases that I can mention when their right is violated in this fashion, then they are being denied a fundamental human right guaranteed by India's constitution. And I think we need to, so what I'm arguing for is an articulation of this as a fundamental human right and not just as a law again. Because like I said, I think in this moment, we need to go back to a lot of our basics. I believe we need to use the courts to highlight pushbacks and to use individual cases of children who have been denied their rightful equity in education and use those children, get those parents and get them to file case after case on a violation of their fundamental human right to an education, a constitutional violation. So I think the nature of the political campaign has to work in sync with other such political campaigns in this moment that are centered around Article 14 and Article 21. And I think we need to embed education as a fundamental right very, very firmly there. Let me talk briefly about what Anita had suggested, and Annie has also suggested, discrimination. It is something it's been my privilege to work over the years with Annie Namala herself on the idea of discrimination. And to me, it is still alarming that even within the RTE movement, at a time when all weaker sections are under attack, like I said, there is a kind of an upper caste, Brahmanical, patriarchal, majoritarianism afoot in this country. But it is undeniable to anyone that the stated enemy of this regime is the Indian Muslim. Muslims are being stripped of their rights to public places, right to eat, right to, and of course the citizenship law highlights that. And yet it is incredible. And I think it should be a wake up call for all of us that we have still not been able to succeed in modifying Section 2D of the RTE Act to notify minority children as disadvantaged. That change has not happened in the central law. So in a sense, almost all the provisions of disadvantage, and in fact, in Section 8 and 9, both you see the word discrimination being used in the RTE Act, but actually it does not apply to Muslim children because they do not fit the definition of disadvantage in the law. And I would urge people in the RTE forum, I would be happy to share with you very detailed recommendations on ways to tackle discrimination. Annie Namala was very much part of those conversations many years ago. I would be happy to share with you those recommendations on how we can propose to tackle discrimination in our schools for Dalits, for Muslims, and for girls. But certainly notifying minority kids under Section 2D has to be a very basic place for us to start. You know, there is some work on the sociology of the classroom certainly happening. Annie Namala's organization has done work. The education department at Jamia Millia Islamia has done some work, but it is not work that is out there as a substantial body of knowledge that we can build on and make a case nationally and internationally how much the schools are potentially damaging and undermining Dalit children, Muslim children. There is no recourse, by the way. So if you are discriminated against and you're treated like garbage in a schoolroom, there is no recourse to a law. There is no recourse to a rule. There is no person to go to because, you know, part of the excitement for those of us who work on broad issues of social justice was that the RTE as a legislation, a central legislation, had for the first time used the word discrimination in Section 8 and 9. And India, we must remember, is among the only democracies in the world, a highly flawed democracy, but still a democracy. But a democracy with not a single anti-discrimination law. Everybody's got one. America has it, UK has it, Australia, broad-based anti-discrimination legislation to protect against discrimination, against hate, against differential treatment. And the hope was that this opening in the RTE would expand our ability to develop a much more broad-based movement to finally legislate a broad anti-discrimination. And the RTE did not succeed in doing that. And I think that we need to resuscitate and revive that moment. You know, linked to discrimination, of course, people have mentioned COVID. And COVID is deeply linked. The post-COVID online school focus is deeply linked. And it is, of course, going to be those kids from Dalit, Adivasi, Muslim backgrounds, very poor kids who are going to be denied education. So what we're going to see is, I was actually alarmed last year, there was a PIL in the Delhi High Court and And it was good to see that the High Court ruled in favor of the PIL, but the private schools who opposed, this was a PIL merely asking for tablets and internet access for children, for EWS kids. And the High Court ruled in favor. It was pleasant. And it said that even private schools, as well as government schools like Kendriya Vidyalayas, should provide gadgets and an internet package to poor kids for online classes. And it used the word, because not doing so amounts to discrimination and creates digital apartheid. And that's what we're really talking about. Sadly, there was a stay. It went to the Supreme Court and Chief Justice Bobde stayed it. So we are talking about legal battles that must be waged even though there is going to be a pushback. So I will really not take more of your time. I want to keep my comments brief, but I do, many of these things were stated by all my previous speakers. We are in fact today looking at a loss of a generation of learners, perhaps many generation of learners. We are seeing an acute worsening of discrimination, sharpening of social divides, for which this country will pay the price for I don't know how many decades to come. I think we need to certainly have campaigns around the idea of this as a fundamental human right. We need to, at the very least, get a basic equality declaration in our schools saying this school does not discriminate on any grounds. And I remember we had drafted one many years ago. I'd again be happy to share that with you. I think we need to work on legal strategies. And I think we need to work on new forms of communication, because the idea that education is a human right for our weakest people is not somehow there in the public idea. It is heading the direction of privileged children will get privileged schooling and the rest of them will get vocational skills and they will go into contract jobs. And that is the vision that is working with the government school system. So I would urge all of us to pay heed to what all my previous speakers indeed said. That a campaign is called for, but alliances with larger civil society that's working on human rights. You know, you will not have Amnesty and Human Rights Watch focusing on education because it is not seen as right to life and personal liberty. And I believe we need to bring this idea of denial of education as a form of deep violation of a child's human rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Farah. I think your contribution has really opened up the whole concept of right to education, not just accessing the right to education, but the right of education being the part of our getting the larger rights or being part of the human rights that we all have been given or embedded with. So I think in just moving beyond just a demand for right to education, but actually placing the right of education in the centrality of all our rights to the kind of a vision that we have as India, to the kind of children that we would like to have growing up with. So I think it has also created a larger space where we can look at education as the fundamental right, as a human right. So thank you so much. We've had four very, very powerful advocates, speakers, giving us a lot of ideas as a forum, as all of us across the country talking and thinking about education. So maybe we have only about 10 minutes. Amrishi, I would like you to come in. How do you want? Do you want to look at certain comments and questions from others? Or would you like to, having heard, you know, would you like to make a few thoughts as how we move forward? Kaise aage 10 minute hai hamare paas? Kuch, I think some comments have come in. I don't know whether, Srijita, are there some questions that need to be clarified? Or Amrish ji, would you like to sort of bring some points up?
Sujita, if any comments in the chat box, we can address that.
There were a couple of questions at the initial stages, which I think the later speakers have taken up in their So I think, and there are a number of comments like complimenting the speakers for each of the points that they have raised. If there are any specific questions, people can again just quickly put it in the chat box, and we can take them up.
Can I make a point meanwhile, Annie?
Yes, yeah. Professor.
I think the point that you made, that we should really move for People's Commission, I think it is an excellent idea. I would support that, having a People's Commission created, which can bring a sort of a platform which brings together all of it. And definitely, you know, in that we can really, the campaign mode can be directed through them, and the campaign can be, should include. I fully agree that, you know, we should really highlight how education is part of the right to life. That is how it came. It is not placed, although there is in constitution fundamental right, there is a separate section on cultural and educational. This is not placed in educational and cultural. This is placed under 21 as a right to, because the Unnikrishnan judgment said we need to read Article 45 in conjunction with Article 21. And that is how it became a part of Article 21A. And I fully agree that, you know, we need to really do in that fashion. It should help us if we move on that direction.
Yeah. Yes, Annie?
No, I think there may not be many questions that we need. I think there is an agreement on the issues that have been raised and the strategies that have been placed. I think it really becomes for us to move forward as a forum on how, at this point and within the given larger social political context, how do we make education as a fundamental mobilizing or a fundamental framework for reclaiming the right of citizenship, development, education? So how do we make that beyond just education campaign? So I think it's really a serious matter, and we do see the concern and demand of people. We see the interest of children. We see RP Forum has been able to create a broad framework of bringing together academic people, activists, other human rights actors. So I think we do have a framework and a space that we can push for. So how do we move that forward? I think Farah would like to add a point, and then over to Amrishji to take this campaign in this year ahead. Yeah, Farah.
Just a very quick point. I didn't focus enough on the post-COVID reality that we are living with and the dangers of online. And just very anecdotally, I live in a large apartment building. And I can tell you that as domestic workers are beginning to come back, what you're finding more and more, and I sort of interview them and speak to almost all of them just out of habit as a researcher, almost all of them, the one smartphone is being given to the boy or to boys. And how do you come and work? Because the girl is now becoming the caregiver. And we're seeing a regression to something we had fought against, you know, decades ago, that young girls are not surrogate mothers looking after young children. And we are seeing that again resurface, certainly in urban spaces, I suspect even more in rural spaces. And it's going to hamper the education of our goal of gender equity and girls' inclusion so severely. I mean, I can give you like 20 anecdotes of exactly that phenomenon. Girl looks after younger siblings. Boys are getting the only smartphone that the parents can afford for this online schooling. So I think along with a campaign around a People's Commission, Article 21A, discrimination, and this issue of you know, we might need to do a campaign just for smartphones, a campaign for the internet, you know, something that people seem to take so much for granted. If you campaign for something like the internet for a poor child, it is counterintuitive. Everybody assumes sabke paas to hai, but sabke paas nahi hai. It's the basic cheese inke paas nahi hai. And I think this can also be a focus of a potential campaign in Amrish and RTE Forum's very capable hands. I just wanted to make that little intervention. Thank you, Annie, for giving me time to do so.
Thank you, Farah. I think Anita ji also would like to, give a last thought. Please, Anita.
My last thought is that, you know, even though we have looked at so many things, and I'm so happy that Farah could make it and also sum up many of the ideas that had come. But this is one thing when Farah says, I'm very worried. I cannot campaign for the internet for children just so that they can do their education, because I know education is just completely shifting to online mode. So the kind of struggle that we've done for 40 years to try and say what kind of education, what activities, what meeting together, what talking and, you know, sharing your ideas is just being brushed aside at every level, right from the beginning to higher education. The policy actually says it. So I think I would like to resist that for even privileged children. And I found that when I wrote that, and Times of India invited me for a discussion on digital education, and they kind of edited one or two words which said that only 20% are logging in, or even if they're logging in, really, what are they doing? But the maximum responses they got was from privileged parents who said they are very worried, because this is what's happening. They don't think that this is good for the child's emotional development. They don't think this is good for education, but this is what they're getting pushed into. So I think we have to resist that, rather than say that the poor child needs an internet. But anyway, these are discussions we'll continue with.
We should. Anita, I cannot agree with you more. This is an articulation for a conversation. Yeah. It is a plea for a conversation around what is going on, because I do see this continuing. For the next year, they're not going to open schools. And poor kids have lost already a year. They're going to lose a second year. We need to figure out how we're going to manage this, because this COVID crisis ain't going away anywhere soon. I believe my son, who goes to a private school, but is also, he's just 13. I saw that he lost a whole year of education despite having a computer and the internet. So I hear you. I'm completely with you in spirit. I think we need to have a longer conversation to take this forward. Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. And I think, as you say, it's really many conversations that we need. I mean, we've not really, people have mentioned, what about children with disabilities? We've not been able to really look at them, or, you know, distant areas and Northeast children. There are so many complexities that we have to handle. So I think the forum is some place where a lot of these things can come together, and there is representation from across the country, and people's concern is very, very evident. So I would sort of request Amrish ji to do the closing with all the thoughts that we have presented here, and also plans for moving it ahead.
Yeah.
I would like to take a very short time to
thank you, Andy, for
thanks. Yeah, I think Amrish ji will thank all the panel members, but from my side, really thank you for an excellent time of engagement and discussion and thoughts that we can carry forward. Amrish ji.
Yeah, and this, we received wonderful suggestions to take forward this RTE movement. We are not going to give up this right, which we got after the decades. Take it forward, this fundamental right and this Right to Education Act, to be implemented at the grassroots level. And the suggestions came here, we will compile all the suggestions and we will take it in our national council with the other networks and civil society organizations, because education is a basic component for the development, you know. So we will take it up and we will discuss in our national council and state forums, and we will start this because the what Professor Dubey has said, that they are actually distracting the mind of the people from right to education to NEP. NEP is such a promise which is never going to fulfill. Or NEP is diluting the whole RT and whole exercises, government exercises, moving around the implementation of NEP. And NEP is a very confusing document. So we will take it, RT movement, forward with the help of our state forum, civil society organization, educationists, and all those who work for who work hard for the universalization of education. Thank you once again for to the participants, speakers, and moderator. So thank you all.
Thank you
Amrishi. Thank you all the panel members and the RT forum. Thank you We should have a face to face meeting.
Sure.
June.
Yes.
Yeah.
It should have.
Start, sir.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.